Hi folks, hope you're okay today. Got a bit of a cold, just going to the doctor's. Make a doctor's appointment. Oops, a daisy. Yep. I want to make a video on Dale Allison. Dale Allison is a historical Jesus scholar and theologian based at Princeton Theological Seminary. And he's an absolutely brilliant scholar. And I listened to two lectures of his last night, which I'll post a link to. And I really love good scholars. When I mean good, I mean people who really know their stuff. And he really knows his stuff. I don't agree with most of what he's saying. About 80% of what he says, I don't agree with it. But I enjoy a good scholar who really knows his stuff. And I listened to his lectures last night. And these are my thoughts on his lectures. Excuse me. Basically, it seems to me that Dale Allison's coming across as a kind of postmodernist. Basically, he's saying we can't know much about Jesus. And so I would challenge him on his postmodernism. I would say that postmodernism is self-refuting. Often the postmodernists say, well, we're not sure that we can know anything, but they're very sure about that. So there's a contradiction within postmodernism. And you see that in textual and historical analysis of Dale Allison, where he'll say, for example, that we can't really know anything about Jesus, and then at the same time, he's very assured that under the textual under the text of the Gospels, there is a layer of or strata of information from communities of the time of Jesus, which can give us information about Jesus. So there's a contradiction there with Dale Allison, with his postmodern historical and literary analysis. One thing that I find very interesting, and I think there is truth in this, but also a danger, is he's very strong on negating his opponents and any other scholar by saying that we all come to our scholarship of historical Jesus studies with presuppositions. And, you know, for example, he didn't use this example, but just an example, Renan was a French historian, wrote about the life of Jesus, and when he wrote about the life of Jesus, he was a romantic, and his Jesus is a romantic. So there's an example of how people come to the life of Jesus with their own presuppositions and create a Jesus in their own image. And basically Dale Allison's critique of the history of historical Jesus studies is that every scholar that comes along creates a Jesus in their own image. And he even admits this himself, in that he likes to do intertextual analysis, and lo and behold, he's created a Jesus of intertextual analysis in his own image. And I think there's a lot of truth in that, that we do come with our own presuppositions. But I think there is data there. As Dominic Crossan would say, there is data there is data, and that data stands on its own terms and is to be looked at. So if there is data there, then I would say that we can come to some understanding of the historical Jesus. Now he would say, Dale Allison would say, yeah, well, you can have data, but you could have four different opinions about that data. For example, eschatology, the verses that, eschatological verses that Jesus speaks. It could be the community's interpolation of it, it could be interpreted today in a different way, etc. But still, I would say there's data there, and that data has to be looked at. And I think Adolf Schlatter's correct, an old scholar. That data is to be looked at in its historical literary context. And if we do that, we can find out information about Jesus, really. That's what I think. Oops. So, so, oh, it's busy today. So, some of my thoughts on Dale Allison. Excuse me. So Tesco's in Middleton. So I think that that it's true that there are presuppositions that we have when we come to do our historical inquiry. Everybody has those, and very often the history of historical Jesus studies is that the historian is rewriting the life of Jesus in their own image. And I think it's a very helpful way of critiquing opponents as well. And I think we all have to admit that we all have presuppositions. And I think that we have to be honest about those presuppositions and ask ourselves whether our presuppositions are the best for doing historical inquiry. I think that's important. That's an issue I think's often overlooked. Do your presuppositions provide an adequate foundation for doing historical inquiry? But on top of that, we do have to try and be, as best we can, objective in terms of gathering data and looking at that data in its own, on its own terms and in its own context. kind of like Theodore Zahn and Adolf Schlatter are the kind of models that I would advocate for doing historical and theological inquiry from a historical point of view. Forgive me, I'm not feeling well. I'm going to the doctor's in a minute to get an appointment. So so we've looked at the postmodern view of literary and historical inquiry. We looked at Dale Allison's understanding of presuppositions and how they form our historical inquiry. A couple of questions that Dale Allison brought up I thought were interesting. He said, if you met somebody, we'll call him Peter, he didn't say Peter, but let's say we met Peter and he was an engineer. And then years later we wanted to write a life of Peter, and you wasn't able to interview his family or people that knew him, you would in no way call that a history of Peter. And he said, so why do we call it a history of Jesus? We've not been able to interview his family, etc. I thought that was a very interesting and good point. I think the answer to that is that the historical Jesus is generally 95% of it is public ministry. So it's the public ministry that the disciples are reporting on. So that is historical within itself. That is the public ministry of Jesus. Secondly, I think that, and this is my influence by the Westminster Confession of Faith. I don't agree with everything in the Westminster Confession of Faith. But at the beginning of the Westminster Confession of Faith, it gives you some statements about why we know what Scripture is Scripture. And one of them, it talks about the testimony of the Holy Spirit. And I was thinking, when I was listening to Dale Allison, that how can we say that we know the historical Jesus? And the Westminster Confession came into my mind, and we in the West have a kind of very narrow definitions of epistemology or theory of knowledge. We say objective truth, we say subjective feelings, we have all these very different categories of what we think is truth. We have the correspondence theory of truth. We have our Western way of looking at epistemology. And that dovetails into our historical inquiry, because as we're doing historical inquiry, we do need to talk about epistemology. How do we know what we know in our historical investigation? So the two subjects of historiography, how we do history, and epistemology dovetail here. So how do we know the real historical Jesus? We haven't got all the interviews of his family. We haven't got all the information that we would require. And I think that my answer to that is that it is this statement, that it is the covenantal epistemological testimony of God that guarantees our historical knowledge of Jesus. It is our covenantal epistemological testimony of God that guarantees the historical Jesus. And what that's saying is that that we in the West have our historical tools. We have our intellectual tools, and many of these tools are very good. So we'll have the criteria of embarrassment, or we have various tools in historical analysis. We have various tools in epistemological analysis. But every one of those tools, if God is not in the picture, all those tools can be reduced to absurdity, where we cannot really know anything. So for example, because I'm finite and because I'm limited, I cannot know all the information that I would require to study any specific event at any time at any period of history. I'm only finite, I'm only limited as a human being, even as a collection of human beings. So we're always working on kind of probability. Maybe this is probably right, or this is probably, you know, according to what we know, this is okay, this is right, this is not right. And so there's always going to be ambiguity to our knowledge. There's always going to be the acidity of skepticism, where if we keep asking questions, we're always going to be reduced to absurdity. And that is in the context of science, in the context of history, in the context of epistemology. Once you take God out of the picture, the whole of reality collapses within itself, and the acid of skepticism eats away at everything, to the point that everything can be reduced to absurdity. So, the Westminster Confession, where it talks about the testimony of the Spirit to the Word of God, kind of makes me think that we can knock Mormons and say, oh, when the Mormons say that they feel in their hearts that they have the word, the truth, that's subjective. I don't agree with Mormonism, by the way. I don't agree with their apologetic method or whatever. But from an Orthodox Christian position, our belief is that the Holy Spirit is God. And if there is a God, just grant that for a second, if there is a God and there is the Holy Spirit of God, then that is not subjective, but that would be objective. And if this objective spirit testifies to the historical veracity of a text, then the historical text, with the testimony of God within that text and the Holy Spirit, would give an objective foundation for knowing the historical veracity of the information being given. So the top and bottom of it, what I'm trying to say is, in a more simple way, is we have categories of objective and subjective that we as Western epistemologists and historians have. But I think that the Westminster Confession theologians were well aware of these kind of debates even in their time. Many of them came from Oxford and Cambridge, and they were well aware of philosophical debates. And philosophical debates, they repeat themselves every 50 years. And basically, I think what the Westminster theologians had done is come up with an epistemology to defend the Bible, which actually really is a biblical epistemology. And what I'm trying to say in a simple way is there's more to our Western concepts of epistemology and historiography that you can never get out of the quagmire of skepticism and absurdity in knowledge and historical inquiry unless you have this kind of, I can only describe it as covenantal epistemological testimony of God on the text. And it not only provides the veracity of the historical document of the life of Jesus, it also provides a foundation for every other area of knowledge, from history to philosophy to science. It is the only way to counteract the acidity of skepticism. So there's just a lady in front of me getting in a car. She's wondering what I'm doing. So what I'm trying to say is that when it comes to historical Jesus studies, that unless God guarantees the testimony of the historical information, then we can never really fully know not only about the life of Jesus, but we couldn't even know anything. It is the fact that God is a covenantal God who is relational gives us the foundation. I'll just move up there. Gives us the foundation for knowledge and historical inquiry. I think it's quite simple but quite complex what I'm talking about. But if you go and read the Westminster Confession and what it says about the Bible, and then think about how that relates to historical inquiry. And basically what I'm doing is, what I'm saying is that in our historical inquiry, that we have categories of investigating and saying this is a fact in history, or we have, in epistemology, we have various ideas about what knowledge is. What I'm trying to say is that maybe in our Western culture, in our Western mindset, maybe there are things that transcend our categories that we perhaps have not thought about, and that would actually challenge, and actually also not only challenge us, but also give us a greater foundation for knowledge. And you can see that with Dale Allison. Dale Allison really paints a picture of the history of historical Jesus studies that really is in a mess. And it's in a mess principally because of the epistemological and historiography, and the epistemological and historiographic interconnection that has not been able to be dealt with. The bridge, the issues of the bridge of faith and reason and history and faith, these have not been bridged adequately enough. And so therefore there's always been a disconnect, and there's always been this collapse within the historical Jesus studies of it's just presuppositions of the historical, the historian. And I think it's a lot to do with the Western historians really have not got a Christian worldview concerning historical inquiry. And that's the issue, what I'm saying. I think what I'm saying is, look, we need to have a Christian view of history, a Christian view of historiography, and that would help Dale Allison, and it would help theologians, it would help historians to have a basis for doing history, and then in terms of a Christian view of science and a Christian view of philosophy and a Christian view, etc. You know, in other words, your worldview really informs your academic studies and your academic investigation. And I would say that the Christian worldview, i.e. one aspect there where the testimony of the Spirit to the Word, which is providing you with a Christian epistemology, which you can apply to history and to science and to philosophy, that, and that's kind of where I'm going and what I'm trying to say here, really. And I think that would, I think that's why the Academy with the Jesus Seminar and Dale Allison and many of these scholars in the are really they're in a quagmire where they're not really getting anywhere because they lack the Christian worldview for their scholarship. If Dale Allison's listening, Professor Dale Allison, or any scholar out there, I would encourage you to, I think, go and read just trying to think what would be the best book to read, really. Just Just trying to think. I think go and read Abraham Kuyper's book on Calvinism. Because there, you know, there's a time where I tried to read. I've always been interested in Kuyper, and I do love him. But there was a time I did make a video where I wasn't happy about some of the things he was saying, and I thought it was a bit narrow. But my opinions have changed. And I think that his book on Calvinism, he looks at the history of science and the history of culture. And I think maybe it might be helpful for historical Jesus scholars to read Kuyper's book on Calvinism. And the Dutch philosopher, I can never pronounce him, Dooyeweerd, I think it's Dooyeweerd. And there's a whole batch of these theologians. I think John Frame has done some articles and some. You can find out from John Frame information about these kind of philosophers. There's a whole group of philosophers of Dutch persuasion that are very influential in Calvinistic philosophy and theology, where they've talked about these kind of ideas that I'm talking about. I don't believe everything about Reconstructionism of Rushuni. I don't agree with everything that Rushuni said. I think that Rushuni made some mistakes. I think the Reconstructionists have made some mistakes. But they have been very, very strong on emphasizing the importance of a Christian worldview. And maybe reading some of these Reconstructionists like Rushuni, but taking them critically, you don't accept everything they say. I don't accept everything that Rushuni says. But I think that if you read Rushuni, and if you read Kuyper on Calvinism, if you read Dooyeweerd, and try to develop as a New Testament scholar and as a New Testament and as a historian in historical Jesus studies, try and develop a Christian view of historical Jesus studies, a Christian view of history, a Christian view of science, a Christian view of philosophy, and work on that basis as a scholar. And I think that your scholarship in historical Jesus studies will be much more productive and will have a greater impact. It will have a greater profundity. You will be attacked mercilessly by the academy. But at the end of the day, it will be fruitful, and it will be a blessing not only to the academy, but it will be a blessing to the church. And there's no reason why you can't develop a Christian worldview of historical Jesus studies, but demonstrate an objectivity within that by dealing with your opponents in a fair and proper way, but dismantle their presuppositions. Dismantle them and show that your presuppositions are much better for doing historical inquiry than your opponents or your fellow colleagues. And I think there is this need to go into the intellectual arena in the academy and push back, just like Alvin Plantinga and some of the reformed epistemologists basically created a whole new department of philosophy in Western culture, because they they pushed back. They said, no, we actually, there is a Christian perspective to philosophy. And that's what we need to do in all areas of department of knowledge, really. So, anyhow, really enjoyed Dale Allison's lectures. Absolutely enjoyed them. Totally disagreed with much of what he said. But highly highly informative, highly interactive. And those are some of the thoughts that I was grappling with. Those three main thoughts. Number one, presuppositions in historical inquiry. Number two, postmodernism and the implications of it in textual and historical inquiry. And number three, the epistemological basis of how we know that the historical Jesus. And my own Reformed Calvinistic background of Reformed theology, influenced by the Westminster Confession, but influenced by Dutch Reformed theology of Kuyper and Bavinck, the Dutch Reformed philosophers like Doerwood, and many other, there's many others, and the Reconstructionists like Roschini. Taking all that and bringing that to the table and just trying to thrash out and work out, well, what is it? How do we know who Jesus is historically? So this is not a definitive video. It is just a window into my own mind of what I enjoy, my passion. I really enjoy listening to people like Dale Allison. I don't agree with him, but I thoroughly enjoyed him. Very cultured, very educated, very learned, and totally knows his stuff. And whether I agree with him or not, I kind of respect that. I kind of respect a scholar, even though I disagree, even though I think they're making tactical mistakes. Like, for example, I think, he's made tactical mistakes. He's followed the last 300 years of scholarship in historical Jesus studies without him realizing it, where he talks about, for example, that we can only know, we can't know anything really about Jesus, but there is a crust with under the Gospels where there is memories of Jesus within that crust, and we can get to that crust. And basically all he's doing is what all the scholarship of the last 300 years in historical Jesus studies has done. And basically it's not take the Gospels at face value, but said, look, they are not authority, excuse me, we need to go under the Gospels and find the layers. And basically, what that's all about really is theories of community. That it's these communities that develop these texts. That these communities are not actually rooted in any real connection of the historical data of Jesus. Direct connection. That basically this is a development of community. A community development of past information, basically. And Bultmann was advocated that, and you go right back to the early days of historical inquiry in Jesus. And basically it comes down to, we're not taking the Gospels at face value. It's community upon layers upon community that have added to this. And we've got to peel away what we're seeing at the front and get it underneath. And basically it's not leading anywhere, it's just leading to a dead end, because it comes down to the fact that you either believe that the Gospels are a representative of real data from a real community, or that the Gospels are not representative of real data of a real community, but really are substrata layers within the Gospels of other communities and of other layers. And it comes to the multiplication of layers or accepting the data as the way it comes. And I know that's a simplistic kind of argument and statement. I know that many textual scholars, textual critics, and many variety of scholars in historical studies will see that as naive, but that's what it comes down to. And what tends to happen is secular scholarship tends to go down this line because of its skepticism against the supernatural. Skepticism about God, skepticism about Christian orthodoxy. So there's an inbuilt bias within the multiplication layer theories that have gone on over the centuries, as opposed to just accepting the data. And I can see why people would be more critical, but it's not led anywhere. And it comes down to, again, you've got to have a firm epistemological base for what you're doing. And if you don't have that base, you're never going to get anywhere. And the point is that if you do it from a Christian perspective, you're going to get somewhere. And the data will verify the Christian perspective in the historiography and the epistemological foundations of your historiography. These are just ideas and thoughts. What am I trying to do? If there's a PhD student out there and they think, you know what, I want to go in a new direction, I want to go down this direction this guy is talking about and thresh it out from a more scholarly point of view. If there's a professor out there who's postmodern, or someone like Professor Dale Allison, just listening to what I'm saying and thinking, if you're just open-minded and you just think, you know what, I've gone down this path for years and it's not borne a lot of fruit, I'm going to try this other path. I'm going to go and read Kuyper. It's out of my discipline. I'm going to go and read him on Calvinism. I'm going to go and read Doyerwood. I'm going to go and read Roshuni. I've heard things about Roshuni. I don't agree with a lot of what Roshuni says, but I'm going to read Roshuni and I'm going to read the Westminster Confession. I'm going to open myself up more than I've ever done before to a different way of thinking, because I've been in the guild. I've taken on the intellectual tools of the guild. I've played the guild's game, but at the end of the day, where's it getting me? And what am I? Am I a postmodern scholar? Am I a modernist scholar? Am I an Islamic scholar? What kind of a scholar am I? What is my identity? Am I a feminist scholar? Am I a black liberation theologianist scholar? What is it? Or am I a Christian scholar? And if I'm a Christian scholar, what does that mean for me? What does it really mean for me? What is my responsibility towards the wider church? What is my responsibility to the wider academy? What is my responsibility to the wider culture? And the responsibility is this, is that Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. That's your responsibility as a theologian and a historian, is to magnify your Lord and Saviour. And you say, well, what do you mean Lord and Saviour? There's so many different Lords, so many different Saviours in historical Jesus studies. Well, there's your problem. Maybe you need to realise that you can know Jesus as your Lord and Saviour, and maybe you need to realise that your scholarship has to come under the Lordship of Christ. And once you come under the Lordship of Christ and develop your scholarship in glory to Christ, then your scholarship will have a depth and a profundity and a power that it's never had before. For me to live is Christ and to die is gain, said Paul. Let me know one day if you do a PhD or if you write some new books as a scholar. Let me know if this video has influenced you and if it's blessed you. So God bless you and have a lovely day. Two scholars that I would encourage academics to go and read and study and work on and develop your historical Jesus studies. And any studies concerning textual criticism, concerning theology, whatever, three scholars that I would recommend is, number one, Herman Bavinck. Go and read his Dogmatics, Reformed Dogmatics. Number two, Adolf Schlatter. Go and read his works. And third, Theodore Zahn. I encourage you as academics to go and do that. I hope this video inspires you. And encourages you to develop a Christian perspective in historical Jesus studies. And like I said, I really enjoyed Dale Allison, and I'll put a link to his videos, and I hope that you enjoy them as I enjoyed them. I didn't agree with them, but I enjoyed them. So God bless you and have a lovely day. Take care. I'm going to go to the doctor's now and get a doctor's appointment. All right, take care. God bless.